Sydney, one of the world's big cities, acting place. The bridge is famous and its harbour beautiful, but the centre of the city is cramped and crowded. Melbourne people, with their 1.25 million, aren't much better off, though their streets are wider. Every day they get their crowds and noise. Just across the Tasman is a country which has only 2 million people altogether. And these two Melbourne friends have ideas about a holiday that'll really get them away from crowds. Yes, it's easy to get to New Zealand. There's a direct plane service from Melbourne to Christchurch, as well as the flying boats from Sydney. There's no passport necessary, and you can have an overseas holiday in a country that's a lot nearer than Western Australia. Seeing pictures of places he visited, Father gets quite excited. The South Island scenery is something he's never forgotten. With a £66 baggage allowance each, the girls find they can take plenty of clothes for 2 weeks to a month's holiday.
Tasman Empire Airways service for Christchurch is now ready for departure. The aircraft to which you will travel is the Skymaster VH-EBK under the command of Captain Wilson. Would passengers please proceed?
With a night flight, not a single day of the holidays is wasted. It's hard to realize that when morning comes, they'll be over New Zealand's South Island, looking down on the Canterbury Plain. Eight hours out from Essendon, and the plane taxis into Harewood Airport. Ahead lies a South Island holiday. With Cathedral Square as its centre, Christchurch has the quiet charm of a cathedral city. Well laid out and attractive, it's a restful place to spend a few days before going further afield. In their river and their parks, Christchurch people take special pride. Trotting in Christchurch has a big following, and the Addington course is one of New Zealand's best. Australians find New Zealanders as keen on racing as they are. Cup week in November is the time for Christchurch's big racing events. From the Canterbury Jockey Club's course at Riccarton, many a New Zealand horse has galloped its way to the Melbourne Cup field. Also popular with visitors is the sightseeing trip over the Port Hills. The contrast between the orderliness of the city and the ruggedness of the nearby hills is one of the surprises of Christchurch. Less than half an hour from Cathedral Square, the buses climb to the summit road with its endless views of sea and plain. On the other side of the hills from Christchurch is its port of Littleton. Just over 100 years ago, the first settlers, the Canterbury Pilgrims, on their way to found Christchurch, reached the top of the hill where the visitors now stand. More early history was made at Akaroa, 50 miles from Christchurch. The French founded a settlement here, and the whaling tripod is the last relic of the old whalers. This pleasant holiday and fishing village is a thought for Christchurch people. Christchurch is the starting point for the two main trips round the South Island. The first, taking about 10 days, is north from Christchurch to Hanmer. From there over the Southern Alps and down to the west coast. Then south to the Franz, Josef and Fox Glaciers. From the glaciers, the route is back up the coast, then through the Alps back to Christchurch. When traveling, visitors have the choice of joining conducted parties or traveling on their own by ordinary travel services. Hanmer, 90 miles from Christchurch, is the first stop. With its hot springs, it's long been famous as a health and holiday centre. Like most of the South Island holiday places, Hanmer has its visitors all the year round. In winter, when the encircling mountains are snow-capped, it has, for some, its greatest appeal. For others, there's the autumn, when the larches and beeches of the state forest turn to gold. From Hanmer to the west coast is 140 miles, an easy day's travelling. With so many attractions in a small area, there are no long distances to be covered on these trips. Today's run is through the beautiful beech forests to cross the Alps at Lewis Pass, 3,000 feet up. The sudden changes in scenery are one of the delights of travelling in New Zealand. The Bullet Gorge, a famous scenic drive since horse and coach days, brings travellers down to the west coast. At Punakaiki are the Pancake Rocks, fancifully named because of a resemblance to piles of pancakes. Beneath are huge caverns into which the sea rushes at high tide. Just across the Tasman lies Australia. This is the part of the New Zealand coast nearest to the Australian mainland, 1,000 miles away. Diggers to the gold rushes were the west coast's first settlers, and today a few old-timers still make a living by prospecting in the creeks and rivers. Huge piles of stones left by sluicing and gold dredges are monuments to more mechanized ways of gold winning. Several dredges are still working. The ribbon of road that leads south to the glaciers passes lakes and bush. The drive through the luxuriant rainforest with its thick undergrowth is one of the most memorable of the trip. Visitors have the choice of stopping at either the Franz, Josef or the Fox glaciers. Only 15 miles separate the two. One of the first things to see is the little church at Franz, Josef. Beautifully set in a clearing in the bush, its altarpiece is a window looking out onto the glacier. For the trip to the glacier, dress is informal. The hotel helps out with useful footwear, though it isn't quite what's worn on Collins Street. The Franz Josef and the Fox glaciers are among the wonders of the world. Nowhere outside the Arctic regions do glaciers flow down to such low levels. The foot of the Franz Josef is only 700 feet above sea level. Nowhere else is it quite so easy to climb onto a glacier. Experienced guides lead the party over the ice on a day's outing that'll long be remembered as a unique experience. The glaciers rise among the highest peaks of the Southern Alps. In this area, there are 17 mountains over 10,000 feet high. Flights from the hotel airstrip enable visitors to see the beauty and extent of the wonderful alpine region. The mountains and glaciers, so clearly reflected in the bush-ringed lakes, is always one of the happy memories of the holiday. From the deck to Christchurch is by road and rail. The railway climbs up the side of the Southern Alps and then goes underneath them at Otira. It comes out on the other side, 5.5 miles away at Arthur's Pass. The final stage of the first round trip of the South Island holiday is across the Canterbury Plains to Christchurch. The second trip, which takes about 2 weeks, is down to Mount Cook, then south to Queenstown on Lake Wakatipu, south again to Lake Te Anau and the Eglinton Valley, across to the city of Dunedin, and then north back to Christchurch. On the way to Mount Cook, travellers pass Tekapo and Pukaki, the first two of the beautiful mountain lakes. Again, the background is the Southern Alps, but the setting is different. An open mountain plateau instead of tree-lined shores. End of the first day's run is the Hermitage, a government tourist hotel 2,500 feet above sea level and in the heart of the Southern Alps. From the Hermitage to the Franz Josef, as the plane flies, is only 20 miles. But there are striking contrasts between one side of the Alps and the other. On this side, the glaciers don't fall so steeply, but flow down large valleys. The mighty Tasman is 18 miles long and over a mile wide. In winter, the skiers gather here, for this is one of New Zealand's best winter playgrounds. Background for the skiing are the great peaks of the Southern Alps, with Mount Cook over 12,000 feet towering over them all. Stopping places on the southern trip are the string of mountain lakes. For many people, Wanaka is the favorite. Each lake has its own individual appeal. Wanaka for its tree-lined shores and many beautiful bays. All of these southern lakes are immensely deep, filling the beds of prehistoric glaciers. From the depth of water comes the beauty of their colouring. Wanaka has a peaceful charm. Lake Hawea, 15 miles away, a boldness that is strikingly different. From Wanaka, the trip continues over the Crown Range and down the zigzag. Visitors not used to mountain roads find this drive both exciting and enjoyable, thanks to the careful driving of New Zealand bus drivers. In a sheltered hollow lies Arrowtown, a peaceful village now, but once a roaring gold mining town. Fabulous finds of gold brought men from the Australian and Californian diggings and all parts of the earth. Where once it counted its population in thousands, Arrowtown can now count it in a couple of hundred. Gold also brought people to Queenstown on Lake Wakatipu, but today they come to admire the scenery, for this is the best known of the southern holiday resorts. The steamer trip to the head of the lake is one of Queenstown's most popular attractions. Rivaling the lake trip in popularity is the drive to Skipper's Gorge. This road was built to bring out gold from a rich gold field. Fortunes were made on every sandbank of the Skipper's River in the gorge below, and a suspension bridge higher above the water than Sydney Harbour Bridge was thrown over a canyon. Men did amazing things for gold, and now the road, the bridge, and an old hotel are the only monuments to their energy. Queenstown is very much a year-round resort. In winter, large crowds come for the skiing at Coronet Peak. This rolling country, with its open slopes, provides good skiing for both beginners and experts. Now is the largest of the southern lakes. In its 250 miles of shoreline, there's great variety of scenery, from the open country along its eastern shores to the long fjords running into the mountains in the west. This region, with salmon in the lakes and trout in the streams, comes near to being an angler's paradise. To fish in the Eglinton is to have sport and scenery combined, for the drive up the Eglinton Valley to Milford Sound is one of the most beautiful in New Zealand. On the floor of the valley are the beech forests. On either side, the peaks of the Earl and Ailsa Mountains. For 30 miles, the drive leads through unforgettable alpine scenery. The Homer Tunnel will carry the road through to Milford Sound, most famous of the West Coast fjords. A flight by amphibian plane over this region will reveal yet more spectacle and beauty. From mountain-locked Lake Quill, the Sutherland Falls tumble down for nearly 2,000 feet, one of the longest drops in the world. Some of this country is so inaccessible that it has not yet been explored on foot. The plane brings us back to Lake Te Anau. Miles from the government tourist hotel at Te Anau, the Waiau River drains Lake Manapouri, the last of the great southern lakes. Manapouri, with its many bush-clad islands, has yet a different appeal. For many, it's the most beautiful lake of all. From Manapouri and Te Anau, the trip is now across to the other coast of the South Island, to Dunedin. St. Clair and St. Kilda are Dunedin's favorite ocean beaches. Dunedin is a city built on steep hills, which only cable cars could climb. Nowadays, buses are replacing them, and the High Street line is the last of the cable cars. Dunedin was founded by Presbyterian Scots, and its people are still proud of their Scottish origin. In the Octagon, centerpiece of the city, pride of place goes to the statue of Robbie Burns. From Dunedin back to Christchurch, and the second round trip finishes. A last visit to the Port Hills, and the holiday is nearly over. A holiday that could have few equals in any part of the world for the beauty and variety of its scenery. Real regrets, visitors leave behind them New Zealand's South Island.